Recorded Books presents Breakneck by Marc Cameron, narrated by David Chandler. Oh, from this time forth, my thoughts be bloody or be nothing worth. From Hamlet by William Shakespeare. Prologue. Alaska. Gladys Tamaganuk's husband, Pete, was the one who decided they should all go upriver to catch ducks, and she would never forgive him for it. It was June, Kagun in Gladys's native Yupik, when fish would soon be so plentiful you could hit them with a stick. The ice had gone off the main Yukon just the week before with much destruction and shrieking. Gladys made almost as much noise when she spied the new hickey on her 15-year-old son's neck. That damned downriver girl, Agnes Pulte, was the culprit. Gladys called her Utgutsunik, one who looks like a wart. Pete assured her Emmett was just going through a phase. Boys would be boys. When Gladys pointed out that those same boys were already cozying up to their 12-year-old Winnie, Pete started getting the boat ready for duck camp. Emmett took care of the shotguns and the 270 Winchester rifle, Gladys's camp gun. They were bound to be bears about. Winnie helped pack their basic supplies: flour, oil, salt, sugar, coffee, and a gallon baggie full of smoked salmon strips, the last of the previous year's harvest. Two dark blue boxes of Sailor Boy pilot bread went on top of everything. More of a hard cracker than bread, each piece was the diameter of a hockey puck, and good with everything from peanut butter to seal oil. It was a staple in bush Alaska. All chubby cheeks and smiles, baby Martha enjoyed the ride up and down the riverbank, swaddled in soft cotton in the back of Gladys's summer gusbuck. Moose camp, berry camp, fish camp, or duck camp, the Tamaganuks were pros, and they had the boat loaded in no time. Gladys's worries began to melt away from the first growl of the propeller biting the turbid brown waters of the mighty Yukon. The river was wide here, swollen by spring floods to almost a mile across. Sandbars had popped up in new places since last summer, and rafts of ice floated by like killer torpedoes. The mouth of the main Andrevsky was less than 2 miles upriver, just around the corner. St. Mary's, a couple of miles north of that. A series of crescent sloughs and side channels, the east fork of the Andrevsky snaked between the main river and the Chulnik, meandering south and east before turning northward through the low Nulato hills. It was called Kukoklik in Yupik, the middle one. Pete pulled the tiller toward him, avoiding a sandbar as he cut up the channel. A grayling leaped on the sun-dazzled surface, biting at some unseen insect or bit of fluff. The sight of it filled Gladys with hope for a good supper. The normally clear waters churned and frothed, swollen and cloudy with silt. Jagged rafts of old ice grew more plentiful as the little boat motored upstream. Pete wove his way carefully, keeping well clear of the bergy bits. His dad had died falling through rotten ice, and he harbored a healthy respect for it. 2 hours after the Tamaganuks departed Pitka's Point, their little boat nosed around the protected bend they all knew so well. Gladys marveled at how much of the bank had simply vanished. Thick cottonwoods that she'd known for decades were gone, sheared off during breakup and taken downriver. What had once been a gentle slope had been gouged into a steep, muddy cliff 5 feet high. Emmett gave his sister a stiff elbow and call dibs on any fossilized mammoth teeth or ivory they might find in the newly exposed earth. Gladys clapped her hands, elated when she saw the plywood shelter was still intact. Pete reversed the prop for a short burst and then lifted the motor out of the water. Momentum carried them in. Skunk cabbage and purple sedge sprouted on the wet bank amid patches of ice and snow. 20 feet upriver, an otter zipped down a mud chute and slipped beneath the surface with a squeak. Emmett and Winnie crowded into the bow, their bulky life jackets fighting for the best spot. Winnie grabbed the bow rope, the sleeves of her purple hoodie pushed up on her little forearms, ready for work, and scrambled over the side the minute they scraped gravel. She sloshed up the bank to take a loop around a cottonwood that had survived the ice dams. Emmett gripped the bow with both hands and threw his weight backward, tugging the boat closer to the bank so his mother wouldn't get her feet wet. The grunt of winging ducks drew everyone's attention upward. If there was a more beautiful duck than the strikingly black and white eider, Gladys had never seen it. Pete stood at the sight, teetering the aluminum hull against the gravel. Never much of a talker, he turned his head to follow the winging birds. Gladys smiled, happy her husband was such a good hunter. "You boys catch us dinner," she said. "Me and Winnie will unload the boat." Pete raised both eyebrows. In other parts of the world, the expression might convey amusement or surprise, but to Gladys's people, who might have to sit silently for hours waiting to catch their food, it was a quiet way to say, "Good idea." Baby in the back of her gus buck, Gladys trudged up the hill to the little cabin. It was a shack, really, with a blue tarp roof, weathered plywood walls, and one long window Pete had salvaged from the rear of an old Ford pickup truck. The door was unlocked. A thief might just break it down, and someone caught in a blizzard might need shelter. "Teapot's been moved," Gladys said as soon as she stepped inside. Winnie crowded around her mother and surveyed the 16x16 interior. There was plenty of light thanks to Pete's pickup cab window. "Did they take stuff?" Gladys scrunched her nose. "No." The furnishings were sparse. 4 metal folding chairs, a set of bunk beds built from 2x4s, a similar crib, and a double bed with a rusted metal frame. A plywood shelf ran along the wall beneath the truck window. Spattered grease stains marked the spot where she would put her 2-burner camp stove. The Coleman lantern was still hanging from a wire on the center 2x4 rafter, right where they'd left it. Gladys took the lid off a blue metal bear barrel in the corner and peeked inside. "They might have took some tea," she said, the hushed clucks of a mother hen. "Probably hunters who'd needed to warm up. That's okay." A half hour later, the beds were laid out. A fire snapped in the wood stove, and the baby snored softly in her crib. Winnie reached into her day pack for a paperback copy of The Hunger Games she'd gotten from the trooper book boat. Gladys held out a 5-gallon bucket. "Fill this up. Then you can read." Winnie went out the door, book in one hand, bucket in her other. It took 15 minutes before Gladys started to worry. She opened the door and called out, cupping her hands so as not to wake the baby. No answer but wind and water. She was probably lost in her book. Gladys called again. Nothing. Exasperated, she scooped up the startled baby and stomped down the hill, 270 rifle in hand. Only minutes before, the river had brought her so much joy. Now it took on a sinister gulping sound, as if it were hungry. Heart in her throat, Gladys searched up and down the bank, bending willows, parting grass, looking for any sign or track. Then a cake of dirty ice, the size of a car door, slammed into the mud exactly where Winnie would have been getting water. Seconds later, a huge log came around the bend. It caught the same eddy and gouged a furrow in the bank before spinning back into the current. All the blood drained from Gladys's face. If Winnie had been reading and shown the river her back. Beyond panicked, Gladys set the baby on a patch of grass and fired three shots into the air. She worked the bolt quickly, screaming all the while for her missing child. The baby flinched at the gunfire and began to wail along with her mother. It seemed like forever before Pete and Emmett crashed through the willows. Emmett carried not only his shotgun, but a yellow 5-gallon bucket. "I found this floating downriver," he said. "Mom, what's—" "Winnie's missing," Gladys pointed at the churning brown water. Her knees buckled and she had to grab her husband to keep her feet. Emmett scuffed the bank with his boot. He looked up at his father. "Here's one of her tracks." Gladys clutched the baby to her chest. "Look at this, Dad," the boy said. "She's facing away from the water, leaving. We should have passed her when we came up." Pete wheeled. "Come on. She might be hung up in a sweeper or some willows." He stopped abruptly, turning back to Gladys, his bronze face twisted with the worry of a man who'd lost his father to the river. "How long's she been gone?" Gladys told him. "Come, come." Pete flicked his hand at Emmett.
"Hold on, Dad," the boy said. "This track, it's different."
Pete glanced at the mud. "Probably when we were unloading the boat. Now come."
"I don't think so," Emmett said. "Different heel."
Pete cuffed his son on the shoulder. "I told you, let's go. Dirt's too tore up to see anything for sure." He crashed into the thick brush with Emmett on his heels, both shouting Winnie's name. Gladys waded knee-deep into the water beside their skiff, screaming for her little girl until her voice cracked. In her haste, she missed the fresh boot track in the mud. Russia. 1,500 miles to the east of Alaska, a man with feral eyes and a hatchet face held court from a tufted leather booth in the back of Agon Iliot, which meant fire and ice, his back alley nightclub off Primorskaya Street in the Russian city of Petropavlovsk. A hint of rotting seaweed from nearby Avacha Bay muddled with the pungent body odor and eye-watering perfumes of the three women crammed into the booth with the man. Low, moaning music throbbed in time with pulsing lights, illuminating three cages and, more important, the nubile dancers inside them. 2 dozen men sat at low tables around the stage, all entranced, swaying, drinking the hatchet-faced man's booze and throwing wads of cash at his women. When Maxim Volkov was a boy, his friends had called him Toporok. In English, it would have been Little Axe, and not only for the severe angles of his face. He was a fighter, prone to fits of rage. The tail of a black dolphin tattoo the size of his thumb peaked above the rat's nest of gunmetal chest hair spilling from the open collar of his silk shirt. The ink was a memento of another time when the air smelled not like the sea, but of misery and urine and fear. In Penal Colony Number 6, he'd earned another nickname, Kostolom, Bonebreaker. Volkov's lieutenant, a handsome silver-haired man with a pencil-thin mustache, stood at the end of the booth with a phone pressed to his ear. He pulled the device away and gave a slow shake of his head. No answer, boss, he said. The music made lip reading a necessity. At 46, 5 years Volkov's junior, Ilya Lipin had earned tattoos in the Black Dolphin prison as well. All had been applied with a jury-rigged electric razor motor, plastic from a melted toothbrush, and a straightened staple from a fat book in the prison library. Ink was made of boot polish and piss, preferably from the person getting the tat. Volkov had decided early in their acquaintance that Lipin's handsome face and prematurely silver hair made him perfect for politics or the cinema. Even in prison, he advised the man to keep the tattoos concealed under his clothes, mindful of a time when they might wish to blend with the world. No answer, Volkov muttered, as if the notion was inconceivable. Lipin shook his head, his mouth pinched in a frown, demonstrating to his boss that he was disappointed at the current situation, too. The tendons in Volkov's neck thrummed as if carrying high voltage. People he could bend to his will. Phone lines, satellites, undersea cables. Those did not care that he was a feared leader of the Bratva, known as the Russian mafia or mob in the West. One of Volkov's many mistresses, a raven-haired waif named Kira, cuddled up beside him. Even she wasn't sure how old she was, but Volkov put her at around 16, if he happened to think about her age at all. He gave a nod to Lipin to try the call again, and then turned his attention to the pudgy naval officer standing before his table. The man kept his head up, shoulders back, but rubbed his sweating hands at his waist like a housefly, at once nervous and defiant. It is Bukin, correct? Yes, the man said. Gennady Arkadyevich Bukin. Volkov toyed with an empty vodka glass, turning it back and forth as if grinding something against the table. Captain of the third rank, he noted. Stationed across the bay at Rybachi Naval Base aboard Special Mission Submarine BS-64, Podmoskovye. This is sensitive information, the captain stammered. How did you come by? Volkov cut him off. You owe me money, Gennady. And I will pay, the captain said. I only need... You have money to spend at my competitor down the street. That was an error in judgment, the man said. It will not... Volkov pushed the glass away and sat back on the soft leather between his women. I am curious, he said. The Russian Navy is very strong, the captain squirmed. When no question came his way, he said, Yes, stronger than me, do you suppose? The Navy is larger. Volkov nodded, considering this. I am not large, he said. Does that mean I am not strong? Bukin flinched like he'd been slapped when Volkov snatched up a mother-of-pearl spoon and slathered a blin with caviar from a large bowl in the center of his table. The mafia boss eyed the younger man while he chewed. Then, out of nowhere, Volkov grabbed young Kira by her face and squeezed hard, grinding hollow cheeks against her teeth. The girl hung there in his grip, sobbing quietly, obediently. She was startled, but not at all surprised. Bloody saliva trickled from her pursed lips. Volkov held her for a time, his nose inches from hers, face canted to one side as if puzzled. He pushed her away just as suddenly as he'd grabbed her. She collapsed into the booth beside him, rubbing her face, obviously too terrified to run or make a sound.
And there you have it, Captain Gennady Arkadyevich Bukin. Volkov used a linen napkin to wipe the girl's tears and spittle off his fingers before popping another bite of caviar into his mouth. That, he nodded sideways to the quivering girl, that was for nothing. Can you imagine what I would do to her if she had done something? The captain trembled more than the girl now. Volkov studied him for a moment and then glanced at Lipin. Still no answer. The mob lieutenant shook his head. Ignoring the Navy man, Volkov snatched the phone away and pressed the button to redial, cursing the fast, busy signal. I told the boy to expect my call, he said, drawing a nod from the stoic Lipin. Finally, on Volkov's third attempt, a male voice crackled over the line, an American speaking barely passable Russian. Sashinka, he said, using the informal diminutive for Alexander. He wished the boy's Russian was better, but that would be remedied soon enough. For now, Volkov spoke English, getting straight to the point. It is your father. Papa, the boy said. I was hoping you would call. Do you have any newspaper clippings about grandfather? I need you. I'm on a fishing boat, the boy said. We should be in Kodiak. Not Kodiak, Volkov snapped. I thought your boat berths in Homer. I expected you would come to Anchorage from there. Wait, Alex said, suddenly more animated. You're in Anchorage? Soon, Volkov said. And I want my son there to meet me. We have much to discuss. When do you arrive in Homer? I don't know, the boy said. 4 days, maybe 5 or 6. We only left Dutch Harbor yesterday. No, 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 Volkov said. Why 5 or 6 days? It should not take you this long, even all the way from Dutch Harbor. I already told you, Alex said, sounding flippant, far too much like his mother. The skipper wants to stop in Kodiak for a few days. Volkov rubbed a hand across his jaw and barked an order to Lipin, who took another phone from his pocket. Very well, Volkov said to his son. I will make you reservations to fly from Kodiak to Anchorage. Lipin looked up from his phone and shook his head. Flight's full for the next 5 days, he said. I'm not surprised, Alex said, hearing Lipin's end of the conversation. Weather's been bad in the Gulf for a week. Kodiak flights get canceled all the time for fog, backs everything up like crazy. Don't worry, I'll be in Homer in a week, tops. Niet, Volkov snapped. The girl beside him jerked, fearing he might grab her face. A week does me no good, no good at all. Tell your captain he must sail directly to Homer. You don't really tell the skipper anything, the boy said. He's kind of a... Talk less, Volkov cut him off. Listen more. Okay. Volkov closed his eyes, forcing himself to calm. You are my son, Sasha, he said. Inform the captain you have a family emergency. You must stress to him that you have no choice. Alex chuckled. He not only had his mother's laugh, which was galling enough, but her glib nature as well. What's so important? It's just a couple of extra days. Had any of Volkov's men spoken to him this way, he would have cut off their balls with a carpet knife one by one so they would have time to think on their behavior. The Bratva boss took a deep breath and then said, I must see to someone personally. I want you by my side. The boy was uncharacteristically silent for a time. Okay. When you say see to someone, you usually mean...
Correct.
And you want me to help you?
No, Volkov said, harsher than he intended to be. And yes. Explanations will come. For now, convince your captain.
I'll try, the boy said.
Can I ask you something?
Of course.
I need proof about grandfather. The crew doesn't believe...
Focus, Alexander, Volkov chided. Call Uncle Lev when you have a time of arrival in Homer. He will work out transport to Anchorage. Then we will discuss your grandfather.
Volkov ended the call and slipped the phone in his pocket. He glanced at the Navy man.
You are still here.
I thought you wanted me to stay.
I did, Volkov said. We could spend an endless amount of time on this.
Do you want to know what I think?
The captain ran a trembling tongue across his lips. It was clear that he did not want to know at all, but he gave a tentative, squeaky,
yes.
I think that you believe your military rank gives you a certain latitude. You believe because you work aboard a secret nuclear submarine, your debt should...
No,
Buchan stammered.
I promise.
At a nod from their boss, Lipin and a young man named Gavril grabbed the captain by both arms. Gavril was around Alexander's age, dark and handsome, with a Superman curl on his forehead. He drove a boot into the side of the Navy man's knee, causing him to double over in pain. The crowd drew back, heavy with anticipation and dread. They knew what was coming. Volkov's men pushed a terrified Buchan to his knees and then forced him face down so his head was on the step of the booth while his body trailed downward at an angle to the carpeted floor.
Gennady Arkadyevich Buchan, captain of the third rank in the Russian Navy, painted the floor with tears, begging forgiveness for his debt.
Music throbbed. Dancers writhed in their cages. Kira, the sweating waif on whom Maxim Volkov had recently demonstrated his cruelty, passed her employer a heavy wooden walking stick. He shooed her out of his way and rose from the booth to place the thick mahogany against the base of the wailing Navy man's skull. The wooden stick was nothing ornate. Bland, in fact, like a table leg. But it held great sentimental value to Maxim Volkov, its frequent use providing his bone breaker nickname. Gennady Buchan gurgled and pleaded, his hand flopping against the carpet like a pallid fish. The girls in the cages stopped dancing. The bartender climbed up on a stool to get a better view. Lipin had the house lights raised, and Volkov waited a beat so everyone's eyes could adjust. Sometimes men needed to be killed in private, but an audience was exponentially more powerful at driving home his point. I have no time to discuss. He put his full weight on the stick. I must see to someone in America.
Washington, D.C. Depending on the case before the United States Supreme Court, half the country loved Associate Justice Charlotte Morehouse. The other half wanted to see her hanged from a gibbet. Those halves swapped sides on a frighteningly regular basis. She'd learned long ago and was still trying to teach her teenage daughter not to fret over what people thought. Do the right thing because it was right, not because one side of the argument screamed the loudest. At 45, Morehouse was the youngest and, according to Rolling Stone magazine, the most handsome justice on the court. She stood 5'10" tall, and the days she wasn't on the court's basketball court, she spent an hour in the gym reading on the treadmill or stair climber. Shoulder-length hair fell somewhere between dun and silver. Her late husband had called it Gruya. She considered her hair the most interesting thing about her. He'd always said it was on his list, but had a few other ideas.
John Morehouse had passed away a month before the president appointed her to the court just over a year ago. She missed him terribly, but saw his eyes every day when she looked at their 15-year-old daughter. Morehouse pushed away from the desk and stood at the same moment her clerk, also a Duke alum, breezed in with a stack of folders, each containing briefs for pending cases. "Good morning, Libby." Morehouse strode to her chamber's window and looked out toward the Library of Congress. "Good morning, Madam Justice." The clerk set the briefs on the corner of her desk. Libby Weems wore a dark A-line skirt and smart silk blouse, like 1,000 other young lawyers working inside the Beltway. Her brow was knitted, clearly concerned. "Apparently, one of your hosts, U.S. District Judge Markham, would like to show you around Alaska after your speech at the Fairbanks Conference. He's taken the liberty of planning a couple of extra excursions."
"Excursions?"
"He described them as wilderness excursions."
"Sounds
terrifying?"
"I was going to say exciting."
Morehouse paced to the other side of her chambers, much more commodious than the one she'd had as a district court judge. She'd always been a walker, especially when deep in thought. By now, Weems and the rest of her staff estimated the carpet might last 2 years if they were lucky. Weems nodded, lips pursed as if she'd sucked on a lemon.
"What?" Morehouse said. "You mean you don't love a good adventure?"
"Feast your young eyes on this idea of Judge Markham's." She moved to her desk and brought up the image of a blue and yellow Alaska Railroad locomotive winding its way along a section of track between the sea and endless snow-capped mountains. "Ramona is super stoked."
"Wait!" Weems pulled up short.
"Your daughter's going?"
"We notified the Marshal Service this morning."
Still standing, Morehouse scrolled the photos. "You can't tell me that a rail journey through this supremely wild place wouldn't be amazing."
"Honestly, ma'am," the law clerk said, "my idea of wild adventure is a foreign film with subtitles.
What if something were to happen? You're going to be, I don't know, a million miles from the nearest big hospital."
Morehouse chided. "Alaska has hospitals?"
Weems leaned in as if confiding a secret.
"Did you know that there are twice as many people inside the Beltway as there are in the entire state of Alaska? I checked."
"So you're saying you'd like to come?" Weems blanched.
"No, I mean, of course, I'd go if you..."
"Relax, Libby," Morehouse said. "I won't drag you along."
"You should watch a couple of episodes of Alaska State Troopers," the clerk said, slightly breathless. "Volcanoes, earthquakes, plane crashes, not to mention 10-foot grizzly bears and ginormous moose that all want to stomp you to death. And..."
Her voice trailed.
"Spill it,"
Morehouse said. "What else?"
"With all due respect, ma'am," Weems said, "you have a way of..."
She paused, chewing on her lip, holding back the words. Morehouse narrowed her gaze, chiding.
"Libby?"
"The marshals say you can be a bit too spontaneous," Weems said. "Like you're not worried about your own safety?"
"I'm not," Morehouse scoffed.
"That's their job."
Chapter 1. Supervisory Deputy U.S. Marshal Arliss Cutter didn't see anyone along the banks of the Andrevsky River, but his gut told him someone was there. It made perfect sense. Prey, smart prey, anyway, kept its head up, ever on the lookout for hunters, and Cutter was hunting. 6'3", with a healthy fighting weight of 240 pounds, Cutter took up most of the real estate in the bow. One of three in the boat, he was dressed for the bush,
wool shirt, which was black and green plaid, brown Fjallraven pants, and rubber extra-tough boots. He'd taken off his desert tan boonie hat and clipped it to his pack, revealing a thick mop of unruly blonde hair. It wasn't that he was averse to combing it. The thought just rarely occurred to him. A 12-gauge Remington 870 with a bird's head grip and a remarkably maneuverable 11-inch barrel, called a Witsec shotgun in the Marshal service, rested in a scabbard secured to the waterproof daypack at his feet. Cutter's partner, a 20-something Polynesian deputy named Lola Teriki, hunkered amidships, trying in vain to smash a biting moose fly that buzzed around her face. George Pulte, a village public safety officer, sat on an overturned plastic bucket working tiller on the outboard, torn between chuckling at Lola's antics and watching out for sandbars. Cutter scanned the wood line, wondering if their target was in the shadows watching. 42-year-old Lamar Wayne Jacoby was wanted on a federal warrant for mail fraud, a relatively innocuous white-collar crime, but a history of a violent assault on his ex-wife put the deputies on guard. The Oregon judge who'd presided over the assault case 8 months earlier hadn't viewed smacking someone in the shoulder with a ball-peen hammer as bad enough to hold Jacoby in custody pending trial. The judge had ruled that if the accused had wanted to kill the victim, he would have struck her in the head. Apparently, it never occurred to his honor that the defendant might simply have missed his ex-wife's noggin during the attack. Cutter had long since given up on trying to make sense of judicial fiat, focusing instead on recapturing the pukes that courts insisted on releasing back on the street. Those releases occurred with slightly less frequency in federal court, but they still happened enough that Cutter and his team had, as they say, a target-rich environment. Jacoby legged it the same day he made bond for the hammer assault, precisely 1 month before a federal grand jury in Dallas indicted him for defrauding two elderly women out of their life savings with a roofing scam. Local law enforcement didn't have the resources to spend much time chasing fugitive con artists, and they were all too happy to pass the case to the United States Marshal Service, once federal paper was involved. Deputies from both the North Texas Fugitive Task Force and Pacific Northwest Violent Offenders Task Force worked the case. Jacoby moved around the country like a whack-a-mole popping up all over the place. Other than some flimsy intel that he'd fled to Alaska, there wasn't much to go on. The case literally fell farther and farther down the stack, beneath sexier, more pressing warrants that landed every day. It would have languished for months had a Yupik duck hunter not posted on YouTube footage of his trip along a tributary of the Yukon River and shots of a mysterious white man. Even then, with over 800 million videos on the platform, 7 seconds of GoPro footage would have gone unpursued but for the fact that Jacoby was wanted as a material witness in the murder of a prominent Texas state legislator. A Dallas County DA investigator, aware of the slim possibility that Jacoby might be in Alaska, and interested in duck hunting anyway, stumbled on the YouTube footage during a lunch break. The image was distant and only lasted a few seconds, but facial recognition software put the odds at better than 75% that it was Jacoby. The district attorney was up for re-election, and with a high-profile murder trial looming, his office made a formal request for the U.S. Marshal Service to turn up the heat on Jacoby's fugitive case. As it turned out, an upcoming election, not trying to clobber your ex-wife with a ball-peen hammer, provided the best grease for the wheels of justice. The chief deputy U.S. Marshal for the Northern District of Texas reached out to District of Alaska Chief Jill Phillips, and Lamar Wayne Jacoby's powder blue warrant folder shot to the top of Arliss Cutter's stack. 18 hours after Chief Phillips received the collateral request, Cutter and Tauriki found themselves climbing out of a 30-seat Raven Air Dash 8 in the Yupik village of St. Mary's, over 400 miles from the road system. 2 hours later, they were in VPSO George Pulte's boat, motoring up the Andrevsky. The Alaska State Trooper Lieutenant in Bethel had tasked the two troopers stationed in St. Mary's to assist, but as usual, they were up to their eyeballs and work when the deputies arrived. This time, it was a death investigation involving an ATV driver and a utility pole. Cutter and Tauriki found themselves in the capable, if unarmed, hands of a village public safety officer who would be their boat driver and guide. VPSOs had powers of arrest, but most carried no sidearm, relying instead on a taser, pepper spray, and their wits. George Pulte had grown up 60 miles down the Yukon River in the village of Alakanuk, which he pronounced with a clicky, wet throat that sounded very much like the cry of a raven, and reinforced to Cutter that he would never come close to learning the language. The troopers assured Cutter they'd be right along if nothing else popped up. That meant the deputies and Pulte were on their own. In bush Alaska, something always popped up. The 30-horse Tohatsu outboard pushed the skiff up the river at a respectable pace. Runoff from melting ice and snow put the Yukon at flood stage, giving them a backward current of almost 2 miles an hour when they'd left St. Mary's. Even now, some 15 miles upstream, turbid water eddied and swirled as if it didn't quite know which way to flow. Perched in the center of the skiff, Lola Tauriki knocked a thick strand of ebony hair out of her customary high bun as she swatted at the moose flies. It now trailed across her cheek, pasted there by periodic rain. 5 years as a deputy U.S. Marshal added to her natural swagger and ability to turn her Polynesian princess face into a fearsome scowl, which she now used to little effect on the moose flies. George Pulte took a small metal tin from the pocket of his exterior ballistic vest and offered it to Tauriki.
"Yarrow salve," he said. "Helps keep the bugs away."
A chilly rain pocked the surface of the river hard enough to make a jacket necessary, but not enough to chase away the clouds of mosquitoes and no-see-ums. Lola waved her hand through the morphing cloud.
"Yarrow? Like the weed?"
Willing to try anything, she leaned in and took it.
"Don't work quite as good as DEET,"
Pulte said.
"Smells better, though. I save the DEET for when the bugs are really bad."
Lola grimaced. "You don't call this really bad?"
"Nah,"
Pulte said.
"Bad is when you're camping and the inside of your tent looks like fur, 'cause so many mosquito noses are poking through the net trying to get at you."
His head suddenly snapped toward the tree line. Cutter followed his gaze. Pulte crinkled his nose, an unspoken no in Yupik culture, and then translated by shaking his head for Cutter's benefit.
"I don't see anything,"
the VPSO said.
"But I can feel it looking at me."
Lola cursed at the bugs, slapping her own face while she scanned the woodline.
"A bear, maybe," she said. "Aren't the salmon beginning to run?"
Another swat knocked more hair out of her bun.
"This is so stuffed."
Pulte gave a somber nod.
"Could be a bear, I guess. But I don't think they're too thick yet. Fish been coming in later and later the last couple of years, if they come at all."
The two moose flies circled Tauriki's head like biplanes buzzing King Kong. One got through her defenses and zapped her on the upper lip, incising a tiny hunk of flesh before she could react. Like their southern horsefly cousins, moose flies were resilient little beasts, capable of withstanding a solid, flat-handed swat and still coming back for more. Lola killed one, grimacing at the movement of a recently cracked rib. She flicked her non-gun hand to keep the remaining fly at bay. "Tell me, Cutter, what are you thinking?" Of Cook Island Maori descent, her Kiwi accent tended to clip her R's, making Cutter sound like Cutter. "Just a feeling," he said. Pulte stretched his arm over the water. "This part of the river is bad news. Not good. Not good at all." He shot a quick glance at Cutter, then Lola, eyes wide. "You guys ever been to Hooper Bay?"
"A couple of years ago," Lola said. "Why?"
Cutter shook his head. At one-fifth the size of the contiguous United States, there was still a lot of Alaska he'd yet to visit.
"A girl died in the school," he said. "Utka Tamani. Long, long ago."
"How'd she die?" Lola asked.
"I'm not even sure," Pulte said. "But it must have been brutal. People see her ghost hanging around all the time."
Lola gave him a side eye.
"What do you mean, all the time?"
"That's pretty much it,"
the VPSO said, earnest as a church deacon. "They see her all around the school, library, halls, peeking out the windows. Teachers, students, lots of folks." "Okay," Cutter said. "Hooper Bay's what, 100 miles away? What's that got to—" Pulte jammed his index finger at the aluminum side rail, shaking his head as if his reasoning was all so obvious.
"This stretch of river killed little Winnie Tomaganuk."
He shivered, checked the tree line again, and then wiped a hand over the top of his head to steady his nerves.
"She disappeared just a week ago. Poof. Vanished off the bank. We searched every snag and sandbar."
He stared over the side of the boat into the water, eyes glazed.
"You ever see the big treble hooks they use to drag the water for a body?"
Cutter nodded.
"Horrible thing dragging a river,"
Pulte said over the roaring motor.
"Hoping you find something, then hoping you don't. I'll tell you that much."
His index finger went back to poking the gunwale, punctuating his words.
"We looked for that poor kid for 3 days solid. River ice must have taken her out to sea. It can sneak up and eat you alive if you're not looking."
Lola finally nabbed the surviving moose fly and flicked it into the water. A fat grayling rose from the depths and gulped it down with a burbling splash.
"You're telling me you feel the ghost of a dead child watching you from the woods? I'm a good Christian girl. I don't believe in that shit."
The way she eyed the bank said she obviously did. "That's a tragic story," Cutter said, meaning it. "But no, I don't think there's a ghost in the woods." Pulte shrugged.
"Something's out there, Marshal. Winnie's body wasn't ever found. A bad death like that, I bet her little spirit is just wandering the banks, trying to find a door to the other side."
Lola banged her fist on the gunwale and made a futile attempt at chasing away the cloud of mosquitoes with the other.
"How about some speed, George? Get us away from these mozzies. And knock off the shittery about ghosts. You're creeping the hell out of me."
Pulte grunted, giving a little shrug like he knew better, and then rolled on more throttle. The added speed did little good. Mosquitoes and tiny biting midges, the locals called no-see-ums, followed the boat in great black clouds, pulsing and morphing like specters on unseen currents of chilly air. Lola slapped herself on the neck.
"That footage that's supposed to be Jacoby,"
she yelled above the sound of chattering water.
Where was that taken?
A half mile upriver, Pulte shouted back. Near as I can tell, he was fishing.
He hooked a thumb toward the bank and then caught his ball cap before it blew off.
There's a derelict camp in the woods not far from here.
Lola dabbed the fly bite on her lip.
What sort of camp?
A bunch of end-of-days whack jobs followed their profit out here in the late 90s.
Pulte let up on the gas, slowing a hair so they could hear each other better.
10 or 12 of them pretty much invaded, prepping for the shit to hit the fan on Y2K. This is all native corporation land, so they had to have some connection. I think one of the main dude's disciples was half Yupik. The place was a going concern for a while. Chickens, greenhouses, some goats, a commune, if you want to call it that. Folks from St. Mary's would trade for fresh eggs and such.
What happened? Lola asked.
Not a damn thing, Pulte said. The earth kept spinning on Y2K plus one. I guess the prophet got sick of the bugs and went back to his dental practice in Chicago. The entire group evaporated as quick as they'd come.
But they left the cabins intact,
Cutter mused, waving away a fly.
Yep, Pulte said. Good place to spend the winter if you're running from the law. Kids used to go out there, but everybody says it's haunted now.
Jacoby's file says he's spent plenty of time in the woods, Cutter pondered. He's enough of an outdoorsman to survive if push came to shove.
Hmm, Pulte said. This is a push-comes-to-shove kind of place.
You got that right, Lola said,
more relaxed now that she'd dispatched the moose flies and only had to deal with 2 million other biting bugs.
I'll bet 90% of my academy classmates are sitting in court right now or serving civil papers.
She froze, eyes locked on the far bank, some 75 yards upriver on the left.
What have you got?
Cutter whispered.
Lola shot him a glance, turned back to the bank.
You didn't see that?
Jacoby?
No,
she said, still peering at the trees.
A native girl.
The VPSO smacked the side of his boat.
I told you.
It wasn't a ghost, Lola said.
A kid from one of the fish camps, maybe?
Cutter mused. Pulte shook his head.
Nobody's out at fish camp yet. What she look like, this native girl?
Young, Lola said. Dark hair, 10, 12 years old.
Purple hoodie?
Lola nodded.
I thought you didn't see her.
I didn't,
Pulte said.
Winnie Tomaganuk was wearing a purple hoodie when the river got her.
Chapter 2. Cutter shrugged on his day pack while Pulte gunned the throttle, coaxing the little boat up on step. Get on the sat phone, he shouted to Lola. Let the troopers know where we are and what we've got. Lola wedged herself beside the rail and unfolded the satellite phone's antenna. She plugged one ear with her free hand while she spoke. All the while, she stared so hard at the trees, Cutter imagined they might burst into flames. He liked that kind of focus. It reminded him of himself. Pulte threw the outboard into reverse as he neared the bank, slowing. The bow scraped bottom at the same moment Lola ended her phone call.
Troopers are an hour and a half out, Lola said, hushing her voice in the abrupt absence of the deafening outboard. They want George to stay with the boat.
Screw that,
Pulte said. He'd gotten past the idea that Lola had seen a ghost.
I was the one who had to look Gladys Tomaganuk in the eye and tell her we were calling off the search for her daughter. No way I'm waiting by the damn boat.
No worries, George, she gave him a wink. I told him we needed you as a guide.
M4 carbine in hand, she nodded to Cutter, letting him know she was ready.
One of the first things he'd taught her was that a sidearm was for emergencies. If chances were good, there might actually be a gunfight, you took a long gun. That went double in the bush, miles or even days from any backup. Cutter jumped out of the boat first, tying the bow line to the base of a stout spruce, while Lola covered the woods, rifle at the ready. The VPSO took a quick moment to detach the black rubber fuel hose that connected the outboard to the plastic tank and hid it behind a clump of willows. The last thing they wanted was to be stranded by someone who decided to borrow their skiff. The muddy ground along the bank was a perfect track trap. He found the girl's trail almost immediately and followed it into the trees. 20 feet inside the forest, he paused, stooping low to study the tracks more closely. Lola provided overwatch, scanning the shadows, rifle up to her shoulder. The muzzle went where she looked. Rain began to fall in earnest, pattering the carpet of dead leaves that littered the forest floor. "Talk to me, boss," Lola kept her voice low. She chanced a quick glance at the ground, then got back on the rifle. "What you got?" "New set of tracks," Cutter said. "Large, over top of the girls."
"Over top? That means..."
"Yep. He's behind her." Cutter stood. "Did she make eye contact with you?"
"I don't think so," Lola said. "Looked as though she might have heard the boat and was coming out to wave us down. She was turned sideways, though, looking into the trees. You think she's running from Jacoby?"
"She's running from someone." Cutter nodded at the tracks. "If this is Jacoby, then..."
Lola glanced over her shoulder at the VPSO. "Our guy's got no history of resisting arrest, but he's obviously dangerous and he doesn't want to be found. I'm a little concerned about you being out here with no gun if things go sideways."
"Don't you worry about me," Pulte said. "I'll be fine."
Cutter wiped the rain off his face. "I have an extra pistol if it comes to that."
He carried his grandfather's Colt Python, as well as a small Glock 27. The .357 Magnum made more sense in the bush, but the Glock kept him in line with Marshal Service firearms policy. He gave the trees ahead a nod.
"The abandoned Y2K camp is through here?"
Pulte looked around and back toward the river, getting his bearings.
"We passed it already. Maybe a half mile back from where we first saw the girl."
The three fell into a plodding rhythm. Cutter worked the ground while Lola and Pulte served respectively as overwatch and rear guard. There was a strong possibility that they weren't dealing with a lone fugitive. If it was Jacoby, someone had to have dropped him off and brought him supplies. As this was all native corporation land, Cutter guessed that someone might even live nearby. Individual tracks became harder to discern the farther they got from the river. Birch and poplar leaves carpeted the spongy ground. Mottled and slimy with rot, they'd spent the past winter under several feet of snow and now let off the sickly sweet odor of decay. Here and there, patches of ground had obviously been turned from a traveling foot. But it was often difficult to tell if the creature that foot belonged to had two legs or four. The girl's movements zigged and zagged, cutting around trees, even backtracking a few times to start off in an entirely new direction. The way the ground was kicked up suggested that she was running most of the time, as was the man behind her. A stream, some 3 feet wide, crossed their path 100 yards in from the river, providing a natural funnel as well as a few yards of mud for more distinct tracks. Mostly moose and wolf, but human tracks too. Water flowed into the impressions as Cutter studied them, indicating that they'd only recently been made.
He hopped over the stream, taking care not to disturb any tracks or slip in the snotty leaves, then stopped to read the ground on the other side. Lola cleared the water with an easy leap and came up behind him.
"What is it?"
A cloud of vapor blossomed from her lips on the chilly air. A raindrop hung from the tip of her nose. Cutter pointed to a clear line of the larger set of prints that were relatively free of leaves and forest litter. His left foot pivots slightly and leans in. Here.
Checking over his shoulder, Lola offered.
That's right, Cutter said. But look, he takes two more steps and...
The tracks turn, Lola said, cutting him off. He spun around completely and walked backward a couple of strides.
She glanced ahead, then checked the tracks again.
You think he has a rifle?
That's my guess, Cutter said. Lola quickly explained their exchange to a puzzled George Pulte.
Ever notice how when you look behind you when you're carrying a long gun, you almost always turn all the way around and walk backward for a step or two, as opposed to just glancing over your shoulder like you do when you're unarmed?
The VPSO mulled it over.
I never thought about it, but I guess that's true. You want the gun to go where you're looking.
Cutter was already moving again, bounding quickly to the next visible track, confirming he was on the right line, then repeating the process. If this girl was on the run, he wanted to close the distance before Jacoby caught up with her. Lola trotted behind him.
So our guy has a gun and knows he's being followed. He can't be that far.
She paused, hissing to get Cutter's attention.
Smell that?
Cutter took a deep breath and pointed the same direction the tracks were going. Wood smoke. Wind's in our faces, so... A hoarse voice from the shadows to the left caused Cutter to freeze. He resisted the urge to raise the short shotgun, not wanting to escalate the situation into something worse than it was, which was already bad enough. He had no target yet.
Damn right, the wind is in your face,
the voice said, rough, like rusted barbed wire, or someone who rarely spoke.
While you focus on a whiff of wood smoke, I creep up from downwind.
And?
Tariki's Kiwi accent came through, making it sound like ind.
What? What do you mean?
The voice asked, more than a little bewildered at the sudden challenge. He sounded too old to be their fugitive.
What do you mean? Lola asked. You creep up from downwind and do what? What is your plan exactly?
The voice mumbled.
Don't you worry about my plan. I'm telling you now, leave that little girl alone.
We need to talk to a man named Jacoby, Cutter said. But if it's the missing Tamaganuk girl you're talking about...
So you're not friends with that bald guy?
Bald guy? Lola said.
The one chasing the kid.
We are not, Cutter said, gritting his teeth. Listen.
You troopers?
The voice demanded, growing more agitated by the moment. U.S. Marshals, Cutter said.
You looking for me?
Your name Jacoby?
It is not.
Then we are not, Cutter said. Now knock it off and show yourself. I've got no time for this. Pattering rain and the distant churning of the river made it impossible to pinpoint where the voice was coming from.
Put your weapons on the ground,
the voice said.
Yeah, Cutter shook his head. We're not doing that. He turned slowly to peer into the dense foliage. Nothing.
What's your name?
Lola asked, friendly, like they'd just met on the trail.
Captain Tom. Tom Walker.
Hey, Bolte said. I've heard of you.
He turned to Cutter.
Captain Walker was a soldier at Fort Wainwright. Came out here and disappeared into the woods.
He turned and addressed the bushes.
People said you died a couple of winters ago.
They were mistaken. Listen up, Tom, Cutter said. We have a child in trouble. Get out here and tell us what you know. If you've got a weapon, don't point it our way.
The brush rustled a scant 15 yards to Cutter's 10 o'clock. A gaunt man wearing faded Carhartt coveralls and a backward ball cap stepped out of the scrub. The rifle, clutched in his hands, looked like an ancient military Mauser, the kind the Spanish used against the Rough Riders from the San Juan Heights. Cutter had taken fire from more than one such rifle in Afghanistan, and knew from experience that the old ones were plenty deadly. He guessed Tom Walker to be in his early 50s, but his eyes shone with a fierce intensity that made him seem younger than he probably was. Living rough, it weathered his bronze skin, giving it the shiny, varnished look common to those exposed to long hours of wind. A flyaway gray beard stuck out in all directions, like he didn't own a mirror or didn't give a damn. He clutched the rifle down by his thigh, forward of the action, his finger well away from the trigger. Even so, Cutter gestured with the shorty shotgun, hurrying things along. Set your gun on the ground.
Why? I'm not your guy. The VPSO just told you he's heard of me.
He's right, Pulte said. Captain Tom Walker is kind of famous in this area. We can trust him.
I'm not in the trusting business.
Cutter kept his voice low. He stood completely still.
Put the rifle down. Do it now. The man complied.
Lola moved in and cleared it, popping out the rounds and shoving them in the pocket of her rain jacket. The chamber had been empty, a good sign. She brought the rifle with her when she rejoined Cutter and then leaned it against a tree behind them before turning to watch the woods behind them.
Captain?
Cutter gave a curt nod. He wanted to get moving, but had to deal with one problem at a time.
Walker gave a groaning nod. 14th Cav Scout, 172nd SBCT.
Ranger Regiment, Cutter said, introducing himself as he eyed the man.
I did a fair amount of work with cavalry scouts in Afghanistan. Iraq, Walker said, leaving it at that.
When?
05 through 06.
Cutter knew the 172nd had seen a year and a half deployment in 2005 through 2006, with 26 killed in action and over 300 wounded. He changed the subject.
You describe the man who came through here as bald. What else?
Walker shrugged.
Heavy, especially for living out here as long as he has.
Cutter and Lola exchanged a glance.
Maybe Jacoby shaved his head, she said.
How tall would you say he is?
Cutter asked.
Shorter than me,
Walker said.
A few inches shy of 6 feet.
That's not Jacoby, Lola said.
Where would the girl have gone? Cutter asked. Since she was running, Walker slumped.
He's already got her. I assumed you were friends of his.
Let's go, Lola fumed through clenched teeth. I don't give a shit who he is.
Agreed.
Cutter scanned the ground, a familiar worry roiling his gut. He looked up at Walker.
Did this bald guy see you?
No. He grabbed the kid and just kept going, dragged her into the trees. I was about to challenge him when I heard you all coming up the trail. He either didn't care that you were behind him or didn't realize it. I thought I could. Anyway, it seems smarter to stay hidden and work out a plan to save her than get myself shot and leave her to that guy.
Which way did he take her? Walker pointed south.
Toward his camp, an old compound.
The Y2K cabins,
Pulte said.
That's right,
Walker said.
I used it as a winter place for years until the new guy turned up last fall and claimed it. He's bad news, that one. Hangs monofilament with fishhooks around his compound. Son of a bitch nearly blinded me.
Cutter rubbed the rain out of his face with a forearm and studied the ground again, letting it tell him as much of the story as possible as he came up with the bones of a plan.
You ever see him with a gun? First time I saw him at all was today,
Walker said.
And yeah, he has a rifle. I've heard him shooting it for a couple of months, a big bore from the sounds of it. None of my business. I leave people alone, they leave me alone.
Cutter searched the trail until he found a clear impression of one of the larger tracks. He stooped beside it, leaving Lola and the VPSO to watch Walker.
I don't get it, Lola said. This guy's been around for months, and you've never made contact with him?
Walker gave a resigned shake of his head.
I left Fairbanks to be by myself. Got no use for people, less so for those who try to gouge my eyes out with fishhooks.
But you've seen the girl before today? Lola asked.
She stole some of my supplies a couple of days ago. I tried to talk to her.
Pulte looked as though he'd been slapped.
There were search parties banging up and down this river. You didn't think to flag down a boat?
Walker glared, not accustomed to conversation at all, let alone being grilled.
I'm a hermit, not a moron. Kids from the fish camp skulk around back here every year to get out of picking nets with their parents. I only realized today this particular kid was on the run. I tried to help her, but she just took off. Then I heard the big guy calling for her to come back.
He softened, face twisting as if he might begin to cry.
Wait, Lola said. Those were his words. Come back?
Walker gave a slow nod. Pulte groaned.
He must have snatched Winnie from her parents' camp, but then she got away from him.
And now he's got her again, Lola said. We should get going, boss.
Hold up a second, Cutter said. I need to check something.
He followed the trail into the trees for another 20 yards before he found the answer to the niggling question that had crept into his mind. He stooped beside the tracks, studied them quickly, and then rose, trotting back to the others. He looked Walker up and down, trying to get a measure of the man.
Lift your boot so I can see the bottom.
The hermit turned, balancing on one leg as he kicked up a foot. Cutter checked it, then turned to Lola. Give him back his rifle.
Bullets too?
Yep, Cutter said. He could have shot us when we came up.
Instead, he told us to leave the girl alone. Walker eyed him suspiciously as he took his gun back.
I thought you weren't in the trusting business.
I'm not, Cutter said. I'm in the hunting bad men business.
And from the looks of things, there are at least two of them out there. We could use your help.
Lola and Pulte perked up at the revelation.
I swear I only saw the bald one,
Walker said.
The tracks tell me to believe you.
Cutter pointed toward the woods.
The girl and the man you saw went that way. But there's another set of tracks coming to meet them. This new set was made by someone with a larger foot, and they overlay the others, meaning they were definitely made after by a different person.
Jacoby? Lola said.
That's my guess. Cutter shrugged. Not sure how we're going to do this, but we'll flesh out the plan once we get a better look at that compound.
He looked the VPSO in the eye.
George, with the child in the mix, I'm not inclined to wait for the troopers before we make our move. According to Walker, we were right behind the bald guy when he grabbed her. That means they're still on the move, probably just getting back to their cabin as we speak. I'd rather not allow them time to settle in and fortify any more than they already have.
I'm with you there,
Pulte said. Cutter gave the dark woods behind him another look while he thought, listening to the rain and wind and the hushed sounds of the river a few dozen yards away. We are miles away from reinforcements, he said. If we get into a gunfight, it's just us.
Lola held up a closed fist in solidarity.
Justice.
Cutter shook his head. Just us. Tom Walker suppressed a smile at Lola's exuberance despite the situation.
What do you want me to do?
Use your Cav Scout skills to help us, Cutter said. We'll decide exactly how after we get there, but I'm open to suggestions. Pulte smashed a fist into his open hand.
Speed, surprise, and violence of action.
Sounds like somebody I know.
Lola glanced at Cutter.
Okay, boss, she said. There's a kid involved. Dial it back a notch. You know how you get. I don't want you crashing in and shooting everyone who's not Winnie Tomaganuk.
Sounds like a good plan to me,
Walker said.
Me too,
Pulte said. Cutter turned and followed the tracks into the woods.
Justice.
He liked the sound of that.
Chapter 3.
He did what?
Maxim Volkov's red-faced shout caused the flight attendant on the chartered business jet to turn her head away. Some things were better not to witness. The rich baritone voice of Lev Rudenka, Volkov's trusted friend and former cellmate, poured from the satellite phone. In most circumstances, the sound of it would have calmed Volkov. Now he wanted to kick a hole in the aircraft, or in lieu of that, stomp someone to death.
Forgive me for saying so, boss,
Rudenka said.
But your blood runs in his veins. The boy has your passions, your tendencies. The tendencies, I might add, that have served you well.
Rudenka was one of the few men who could speak so freely. They'd been through much together. Too much. Volkov lowered his voice.
Are we ruined?
I do not think so, boss,
Rudenka said.
Certainly the deaths will cause a stir.
I do not give one shit about the deaths, Volkov said. Is Alex likely to be captured, found out? He is young and has not been trained. The bodies...
He took care of that, Rudenka said. Not to worry. I will help him disappear to the boat.
He will have to show identification to fly, Volkov said. Even between Homer and Anchorage, that is too great a risk after this.
I know someone,
Rudenka said.
Ah, Volkov said.
But can we trust this someone with my son's freedom?
A Russian, Rudenka said. He knows your reputation.
You have done too much already, my friend, Volkov said. I am afraid this will disturb your retirement.
It would be good to see you, but I understand the danger. Do not worry about me, boss, Rudenka said. I will take care of everything here and send your son to you. You have my word.
I cannot believe he would be so rash, Volkov said. At the other end of the line, Lev Rudenka gave a quiet chuckle.
Forgive me, boss, but you should not be surprised. You should be proud.
Chapter 4.
Leonard Jukes would be the last to die. Shortly after coming to work aboard the fishing vessel Esther Marie, Alex made the mistake of telling his crewmates that his paternal grandfather had been killed and eaten by a Siberian tiger. None of the men believed him. Jukes, the boat's electrician and first mate, egged them on. The bastard. It made what he did next all the easier. Alex was 11 when he'd first seen his father kill a man. He'd never personally taken anyone's life, but it turned out not to be nearly as difficult as it looked. At 19, he was the youngest member of the crew by almost a decade. He had his father's pinched face, but was tall and blue-eyed like his American mother.
Unfortunately, he'd also inherited Marine Preston's pale complexion. Even after he spent weeks on deck in the sun and in the wind, his skin remained as white as a peeled potato. At his father's insistence, he'd practically begged Captain Hannigan to bypass Kodiak and go straight to Homer. The skipper, a stooped man with a white ponytail and an unlit briar pipe perpetually clenched between his teeth, actually offered to pay airfare from Kodiak to Anchorage. A quick check online showed what Alex already knew. Low clouds.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.